Thank you. Sunday morning service, first service of 2021. So glad to have everybody with us this morning. Hope all of those who have not been feeling well are feeling some better today. We had several prayer requests come across here. We want to pray for each one of them. Sister Donna Kay and her family, Sister Gilda, Sister Lisa, Sister Amy, and many more. I just saw a few of those as we was getting ready to come on screen. So if you have prayer requests, please leave it there. We'll look at those later and be praying for those. And those of you who have seen those, be praying for them. Some lost loved ones, Sister Debbie's lost sons, we want to pray for them. All of our lost loved ones to be saved. And so we want to lift all of those needs up in prayer. We've made it to 2021. Looking forward to what God is going to do as restoration continues. Not just for the Middleburg Church of God, but for the Church of God globally. We want to welcome those who are listening in on Spreaker as well. Never want you to feel left out. If you have signed in to Spreaker, you can also open up a chat section there where you can leave comments, prayer requests as well. So if you are listening in on Spreaker and able to do that or send me a text message later, not during the broadcast because it comes through on my phone, but send it to me later and I'll be praying for those needs as well. So we're so thankful for each one of you joining with us today. A few more services of this online for those many of you have already seen. I'm sure the post on Facebook, that's why you're tuning in live. I tried to reach out to as many as I could that I had contact information for, so I hope nobody showed up at the church today. So if they did, I apologize for that, but we're trying to do our best to reach out to everyone we can to let them know. But we are online this morning, tonight, and Wednesday night at least. Sister Amy has tested positive for COVID. We believe she's on the back side of it. She tested Wednesday, got the results Friday night. Both my kids' results came back negative. Of course, mine came back as a blood. They didn't take, but I feel okay. So we're all in quarantine nevertheless, and we will test again early this week, Sister Amy, to see if she's got a negative, me to make sure that I do not have it asymptomatic or what have you. So that's why we're online. Prayerfully and hopefully next Sunday morning, everybody will be feeling better. All symptoms will be passed, at least the contagious side of it, and we can gather back together in the sanctuary and get 2021 started. I know we're chomping at the bits. I know for sure Sister Rhonda and our music side is chomping at the bits for 2021. And Sister Rhonda apologized that we've had to put on delay, but that's just the pandemic that we're in, the times that we're in, leaning on the side of caution, trying to protect everyone. But I know she's excited about getting started in her new position as our music director. She kind of got to go into it a little bit in December, but she is ready to hit the ground running in 2021, I know for sure. And our musicians, our band, our singers, our specials, singers are all ready for a great year in 2021. I'm ready for what God has in store for us for 2021. I believe I've got a series of messages ready for Sunday nights and Wednesday nights for the first few weeks of 2021. Got a message that I was ready to preach this morning to get started for this year. I'm putting that on hold until we meet in person. So we're going to continue on the thought that we started last week from 2 Peter chapter 1 later this morning and again tonight. And Wednesday night's lesson message is going to be on humility. So we're going to get started with that in 2021. And then we're going to hit the ground running as we continue our theme, Restoration Continues. So let's pray for all these needs today. And as we're praying for these needs, be in prayer for our upcoming church anniversary, 71st anniversary of our church, our 8th anniversary as pastors of the Middleburg Church of God. We'll have that service on February 7th. Brother Brian Whitley and his family will be with us. Brother Brian will be preaching. His family will be singing for us for our anniversary service there on February 7th. And then that week, we will have Pastor Eddie Sullivan from Foley, Alabama, will be preaching our anniversary revival. So everybody get better, get well, and let's get ready for revival starting off in February, looking forward to what God is going to do in those services. So let's pray for those services. Pray for that revival and ask God just to begin to move and touch and minister to our hearts and our lives. If you have tithes and offerings, you can either hold them until we meet again and bring them then. If you prefer to get them in, you can mail them to stop any online fees. You can just mail them to my address, and that is found there on a previous link on our Facebook page. Just look at that. You can mail them here to the house, and we'll get it in the bank later this week. Or if you want to give online, we have Church Track online. And we have PayPal online. Both of those links are also there in our previous post for the COVID update for the services this week. So you can give that way, or like I said, you can hold it until we come back together again and put it in. Want to thank you for your finishing out the year strong in giving. You did a wonderful job. November, December, we finished out strong. December was in the positive. Last quarter was in the positive. And throughout this year, if I've looked at it correctly, we were in the positive for this pandemic year. So praise the Lord for that. That's from your stewardship, your faithfulness to the church. So appreciate all of those who have made that possible in giving. When we come together again, we will have your giving reports ready as well. So all of that will be ready for you when we come back together prayerfully this next Sunday on the 10th. So that'll be ready for you. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we get started today. I'm going to pray. We're going to pray over these needs, pray for this service, and just ask God to just touch us and help us today. Gracie and Noah's just doing a wonderful job of doing our special singing while we're online. Gracie's doing the morning services. Noah's doing the night services. And, of course, Gracie's normal position of Wednesday night, she'll be doing that as well. So we appreciate them. Give them a hand for their willingness to step up. Appreciate their faithfulness. And Grace will be coming in just a moment to sing a special after we pray. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you. Thank you and praise you today for the opportunity we have to come together as a church. We may not be able to gather in the building, but we're gathered here together on this virtual setting through Facebook and through Spreaker. And I just pray, God, that you touch the heart of the viewer and the listener, that they would receive the word of God with gladness. Minister to each one of these needs. Many within our congregation have been affected by COVID, and some have been mild symptoms, some has hit harder, some are going through it even now, and we just pray for healing and recovery for all of them. And I pray, Father God, that you would just minister to the needs that are present in this setting today. And we just pray, Heavenly Father, those that are traveling, give them traveling mercies, and those that are struggling, that you give them strength. Those that are lost, we pray that you save them. Our lost loved ones to be saved. We just ask you to anoint the remaining part of the service. Anoint Gracie as she sings, and anoint me as I preach, and anoint every heart to receive the word of God with gladness. We'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Worship with Gracie as she comes to sing. Come on, baby. Amen. Powerful song and wonderful job, Gracie. Appreciate the message and song today. Praise the Lord. Take your Bibles and turn with me this morning back to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. And we're going to continue. We talked about verses 8 and 9 last week and said we didn't have time to get to them. Well, we got time to get to them this morning. So this morning and then again tonight, we'll be looking back here in these verses. So if you have your Bible, turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 1, and we'll be reading verses 8 through 11. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 8 through 11. He said, "For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins." Verse 10, "Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to your calling." Give diligence to your calling and election sure. "For if you do these things, you shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." Let's pray. Father, we ask you right now to just add your blessing and your anointing upon your word. Thankful for that song today. I surely don't want to live a day without you, God. I'm thankful for your presence. I'm thankful for that great cloud of witness. I'm thankful for that urging and that constraining that comes from our Heavenly Father into our hearts and our lives to keep us going another day. I'm thankful for the Holy Ghost that is our power source. And I just pray right now for your anointing upon me to preach and anointing upon hearts to receive this word today with gladness. And we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. As we look here in our text, as we looked last week in the first few verses of chapter 1 of 2 Peter, earlier in the year and end of last year, we went through 1 Peter and 2 Peter. And now we find ourselves back in 2 Peter over these last few services. Wanted to just come back and recap this. These were on my heart last week starting off, and then we found out we're going to have to be back online this week. Begin to pray. Just felt like the need to go back and continue this thought as we talked about last week that we need to grow up. And so as we continue on, Peter is writing this book to give us these challenges, not just to grow up, but he's writing to encourage us and to warn us, really, as his readers, the three things that we find here that he's wanting to do in 2 Peter is, for number one, for us to grow in maturity in the Lord. And that's what we're talking about last week and this week. He goes on to tell us to beware of false teachers and doctrines and to be ready for the coming of the Lord. And he began by telling us, as we talked about last Sunday, encouraging us greatly to do this by what we have because of Jesus. What we have because we've been born again, because we've been washed in the blood, and how wonderfully we felt the effects of that last week as we began to preach and talk about that. And we just look back for a moment on that. It tells us, what is these things that we have to rejoice in? Well, we have the same faith that the apostles had. We should rejoice in that. They didn't have some kind of supernatural faith that's not made available to us. They may have walked with Jesus in the flesh, but he said, "I must go away, but I will send you another comforter." So we're not left out. We have that same faith and that same power available to us. And we have multiplied grace and peace in our lives. Why? Because we have a knowledge of Jesus Christ. Not only have we got to know him intimately, but we're growing in that faith and in that knowledge. And understand something. We have everything that we need that pertains unto life and godliness. Did you hear that, child of God? This morning, if you're born again, blood bought, redeemed, you lack nothing. You have everything you need. He said, "I will supply all of your needs according to my riches and glory by Christ Jesus." So if you've got Jesus, you've got everything that you need that pertains to life. He said, everything that you need in life, you have it. And everything that you need in godliness, you have when you have that knowledge of Jesus Christ. Oh, and listen to this. He went on to say, we have the capacity to live a vibrant and a virtuous life. All to understand that you have not yet tapped into the potential if you've not recognized the capacity that you have to go above and beyond the things that you see and cannot see. We have many great and precious promises. We have the capacity also to grow in these spiritual graces, these virtues that we talked about last week. And so that begins, as we begin to think about that and look at that, it begins to raise some questions. The first question what does it mean to grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? We did a comparison of physical growth and spiritual growth a little bit last week, and we're going to go a little bit deeper into that today. Number two, how can we be sure that we're growing in this spiritual knowledge? And why is Peter so concerned that we grow in this knowledge? You may say this morning, Pastor Meyer, you're so concerned that I grow up spiritually, for the same reason that Peter was. They're all good questions, and these answers can be found as we go deeper into our text today. And we see these answers here. So what does it mean? Looking at the first one, what does growing in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, what does that involve? What does that entail for us to grow up spiritually? Well, the number one thing, the first thing, is it involves the development of those eight graces that we talked about last week. And I want to briefly just go over them and define them a little bit to take and remind you of what we talked about last week. The first one, faith, conviction, strong assurance. Number two, virtue, moral excellence or goodness. Knowledge is correct insight. Self-control is self-discipline. Perseverance is bearing up under trials. Godliness is godly character out of a devotion to God. Brotherly kindness is love towards our brethren. Love is active goodwill towards those in need. So all of these that we talked about last week, all of these graces, they should be in our lives as Christians. And I hope that you throughout the week from last Sunday to this Sunday have done an assessment and searching on your spiritual life to make sure that you've added unto faith all of these different graces, from virtue all the way down to love, that you've applied and looked and made sure that all of those are there, and if they were not there, that you begin to make the needed adjustments that they could be added unto you, because they should be in our lives as Christians. But then we go on where we stopped last week, to verse number 8. Verse number 8 reads like this. It says here, excuse me, for if these things be in you, get this, for if these things be in you and abound. Go ahead and type that out with me, or just say it out loud right there where you're at. And abound. They make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Did you get that? If these things in you and abound, there's no way that you can be unfruitful. You'll neither be barren nor unfruitful if they abound in you. That's those key words there, and abound. Peter is saying that these graces must not just be in you, but they must abound in you. And when they do that, that word abound means to exist in great quantity. So what he's saying is that it should be in great quantities in our lives, that they should be filling and saturating our lives. It's not until they begin to abound in you, though, that you're truly growing in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so we understand that this is much more than just increasing your intellect. It's more than just having a mind knowledge. It's more than memorizing a verse. It's more than saying, I know who Jesus is. It's more than saying, I know what it takes to be saved. It's more than being able to quote the commandments, the Ten Commandments. It's so much more than that. It's that those things are bounding. It's not getting more head knowledge, but it is getting it past the head into the heart and having a heart knowledge. So what Peter is saying here is that we must grow in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and when we do that, we're going to strive every day to be like Jesus. Christian means Christ-like. So if you're not doing that, can I just simply tell you, then you're not growing in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. If these graces are not in you and abounding in you greatly, then you're not growing. You've stunted your growth spiritually. And this morning, I challenge you at the beginning of this new year to take a fresh start and do something about it. 2020, your spiritual growth may have been stunted. Oh, but thank God, His mercies were renewed this year. His mercies were renewed again this morning. And God has given you in this first message of 2021 an opportunity to say, I may not have grown much spiritually in 2020, but in 2021, I'm going to add unto my faith these graces. And not only are they going to be there, they're going to abound in me. Oh, because to be like Jesus, that's all that really matters. To be like Him is what needs to be accomplished in my life. I want restoration to continue in me and through me, that I may accomplish what He wants me to be, because I want to be like Him. And so we begin to see that in order to do that, though, that involves some things. That involves some things. That it involves more than intellectual knowledge. It's also evident here as we study that word knowledge. And we see it in 2 Peter chapter 1, chapters 2, 3, and 8. It means to become thoroughly acquainted with, to know thoroughly, to know accurately, or to know well. Peter is saying that our whole life should be about getting to know Jesus thoroughly and intimately. How well do you know Jesus? He knows us very well, but how well do we know Him? It's more than just a name. Some call Him Jesus, one songwriter said, the Redeemer of all men, but I call Him Savior because He's my dearest friend. Oh, we should be wanting to draw closer to the Lord every day. I don't know how much time you spent in 2020 drawing closer to the Lord, but in 2021, you need to make it a mark. Mark it down today. Make a promise to yourself. Make a promise to your spouse. Make a promise to your children. Make a commitment and a promise to your church family. I am going to grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Somebody needs to just fess up and say, I need to grow up, and I'm ready to grow up. And we need to take some accountability and say, I know that I must grow spiritually and take those steps to do so. How well do you know Jesus? How long have you been serving Him? Really is not the question, but how much have you grown in Him during that time is what we need to focus on. And so that should be our desire. That should be our drive. That should be our daily compelling in our heart, in our life. Every day when we wake up and our feet hit the floor, I'm reporting to duty. I'm reporting to the service of the King of Kings. It's not, woe is me, here's another day, but it's, this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Can I tell you, though, it's so much more than that. It's Heavenly Father, what can I do for the kingdom? Too many times we wake up in the morning and we've got questions and we've got things that we want God to do for us. Oh, but when we become a disciplined follower of Jesus Christ, when we become a disciple, it's not about what God can do for us and the church can do for us and what we can get out of it, but there takes a 180 there, and we get into that place to know that He has done so much for me. He's filled me to capacity, and He's given me and added unto all of these virtues and graces, the power and the authority and anointing. He's placed an anointing upon me. He's placed a fire in my soul. So now I stand here on this morning and say, Lord, what would you have me to do today? Not only what I want you to do in me, oh, but Lord, do something through me. Oh, as we begin to grow in grace, that's the transition that takes place. And so the more we demonstrate these graces in our lives, guess what? The more we know Jesus. But on the flip side of that, the less we demonstrate these graces in our life, the less we know Him. So let me say that again, how important it is to really know Jesus. Do you know Him today? Not do you know of Him, not do you know about Him, but do you have an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ? I was reading something earlier this morning about prayer and what prayer is. Prayer is not a one-sided conversation, but prayer many times it becomes that though. It becomes a one-sided conversation. Lord, give me. Lord, bless me. Lord, I need. And we begin to lay out all of our petitions before the Lord. But do you know that's never what prayer was intended to be? That's not even the definition or the meaning found when you begin to study out prayer. What is prayer then, Pastor? Prayer is dialogue. How much dialogue? You say, well, I didn't grow much spiritually in 2020, but I prayed a lot. Well, did you do a lot of talking but not a lot of listening? That's the question. I understand that we say that we pray, that we talk to God. I've heard people say, well, I talk to God every day. Well, I get that, but have you given God a chance to talk? Prayer is dialogue. Prayer is not only telling God what we want, but looking to His Word for answers, listening for His voice to speak. Remember what I said last week. His voice may be the voice of your spouse. It may be the voice of your children. It's the voice of your pastor. It's the voice of a song. God will speak to us in many ways. And so to know Him is to be listening for His voice. Not just talking to Him and telling Him what we need, but listening to see what His answer is and continuing that dialogue. That's how we grow spiritually. And so we understand that the less we do that, the less we know about Him. Because those who do not really know Jesus, they're not going to know. They're not going to know of His soon coming. They're not looking for it. Now take it a step further. Those who don't really know Jesus aren't going when He comes. Those who just have a mind knowledge, they're going to be finding themselves living through a tribulation period and trying to do their best to make it through that. But those who know that they know that they know Him, that they're striving to every day to know more about Him, that's their heart's goal, to be like Jesus. They're going to be ready when He comes. They're in tune with Him. They're in harmony with Him. Second thing is, it involves developing these graces. It involves developing these graces, not individually, but in conjunction with each other. We have that word add. The way it is written in the original, the word add implies before each grace. In other words, it should read like this. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. And add to your virtue knowledge. And add to knowledge temperance. And add to temperance patience. And add to patience godliness. It's not having a faith and then adding virtue to it. And then virtue kind of dissipates and disappears. And you come back and you try temperance for a little while. Knowledge for a little while. And temperance for a little while. And patience for a little while. And you begin to try each one of these. No, it's saying add it to it. So all the while, I still got faith. I've still got virtue. And that knowledge, and just one after another, we're adding to. It's found to support. I get a chorus. When you look at that word in the Greek, it means to lead a choir, to keep in tune, to supply, or to provide. So literally, it means that each grace works together in harmony with all the others. So they work together. They all work together. Can I tell you, they must work together. You've got to have them. Now, there's a little preposition there as well. The word teo, to. Add to your faith virtue and to your faith knowledge. So what this suggests to us is that each grace must have the other one in order to perform properly. Can I just put my finger there and tell you that each one of us need one another to function properly? So many people think, well, I don't need the church. I don't need anybody else. I can serve God all on my own. And I can make it all on my own. And all I need is Jesus. Well, can I remind you that Jesus said that the church is the body of Christ and members in particular. So we need one another. We need these virtues. And we need one another. We need to be a part of the household of faith. That is very important. Understand that. We need each one of these graces need the other. It's kind of like building a wall. Each block must have a block under it for support. So each one of these virtues, each one of these graces need that block under it for support. We need that block under us for support. Scripture tells us that the stronger shall uphold the weaker. And so there's times that we may need others to help uphold us. And so we need to see this. So what Peter is saying is this. Without faith, there will be no virtue. Without virtue, there will be no knowledge. Without knowledge, there will be no temperance. Without temperance, there will be no patience. Without patience, there will be no godliness. And on and on and on that goes. So all of these virtues and these graces work together like a choir singing in perfect harmony. Oh, it's a beautiful sound to hear a choir that comes together in perfect harmony. We cannot pick and choose, church, which graces we want, but we must develop all, A-L-L, all of them, all of them. They say, well, I'll just take this one and I'll take that one. I don't need this one. I don't need that one. No, if we're going to do it, we've got to develop all of them together in our lives. And if we're doing that, we're going to grow up spiritually. If we're doing that, Peter says that we're going to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. If not, we're just fooling ourselves. And not only are we fooling ourselves, we're going through these motions and we're playing a game of trying to fool others. We got to be honest with ourselves. And if we're honest with ourselves, we'll then be honest with others to say, I've been playing the part. It's time we take the mask off and say, I'm not trying to impress, to make somebody think that I'm something that I'm not, and try to put up this facade. We begin to be honest and begin to say who we are and begin to open up and say, listen, maybe in 2020 you put up a facade of trying to make people think that you had all of these things in your life, but you say, no, I realize that many of these virtues are missing in my life, and I need to start off 2021 by adding these virtues in, and let not only they be added to me, but I want them abounding in my life, because we're about to get down to business with this thing. We're about to see God do great and mighty things, wonderful things in us if we get to that place that they are abounding. I want to walk in harmony with Him, and I don't want to try to fool others, and I don't want to fool myself. So if you haven't grown up spiritually, stop fooling yourself to think that you have, and begin to fess up to yourself. Be honest with yourself. Be honest with your brothers and sisters. Most of all, be honest with God and say, oh Lord, I realize how much I desperately need to grow up spiritually. And the third thing involves diligent effort on our part. Diligent effort. God is in control. Some of you may have seen this that I shared this week. God is in control, but He does not expect us to lean on the shovel and wait for the hole. We have to begin to do some diligent effort to let God be in control in us and through us. We look back in verse 5 of 2 Peter 1 and we see where he says, giving all diligence. This word diligent means, once again, eagerly with haste. Peter is saying that we should eagerly and with haste pursue these graces. Eagerly and with haste we should be pursuing these graces. My question to you this morning is, are you? Are you? To grow up in the knowledge of Jesus Christ is going to require much effort on our part. It takes no effort. No effort, really, on our part to receive that gift of salvation. All we have to do is respond. All we have to do, we know that it's a gift of God, and we receive that salvation into our life. But if we're going to grow up spiritually, it's going to take some effort on our parts with proper nutrients, proper spiritual things, keeping the junk out of our lives, and keeping the good things in our lives. And people will tell you, it takes no effort on my part to be saved. Understand that. That does take an effort of bowing down and confessing that you're a sinner. That is some effort. You have to fess up and you have to respond. But understand, it's a gift, freely given. And when you pray that prayer, it's just if you've never sin. But he said, Paul said this, shall we continue in sin that may grace may abound? God forbid. It means now it's time to grow up. If any man's in Christ, he's a new creation. So we've got a clean slate, a new beginning. And now we don't do the same things that we used to do, but we walk in newness of life by doing what? By adding to that faith all of these graces, and we're growing up. It's not just going to happen accidentally. It's not going to just happen because we went to an altar and said, all right, I'm going to start attending church. And we come and sit on a church pew, or we listen into a church broadcast with this attitude of bless me if you can. But it's going to take some diligence on our part. It's not going to happen just because we listen to the Sunday school teacher or the Wednesday night teaching. It's going to come through our diligence on our part. How? In prayer and Bible study and in fellowship with God. Can I tell you, you spiritually growing up is no one else's responsibility but yours. You have all of the resources. And understand that church attendance and being a part of the body of Christ is very important. But don't leech off of the resources that God has put for you there to grow up, for you to just exist, and for you just to take for granted the fact that God has given you a living hope. Listen, the church is a living organism. And so when we begin to understand that that's a living organism, we can't keep depending upon others and the church to do our growing for us. But we have to take those resources that are given, and we tap into that source. Thank God for that source of a godly pastor and leadership and a church that we can feel the power and the presence of God, for a setting like this that we can come on and hear the Word of God and receive the Word of God. But we can take and pull all of that into our house if we want to, but if it's not abounding and if it's not working in and through us, what has it really done? It's just given us a lot to think about, right? A lot to think about. Many of you have had a lot to think about in 2020. But have we got it past the mind, into the heart, and into the hands, and into the feet, to be diligently about the Father's business? It's going to come through diligence. In closing this morning, I want to share this illustration. We need to be careful that we're not like the teacher Ray Steadham told about. He said a teacher had been teaching school for 25 years, and a certain position came open that would be a promotion to that teacher. So she applied for the position. However, someone who had only been teaching for 1 year got the job. The teacher was upset about that and went to the principal and asked why the other person got the job with only 1 year experience. And she was rejected after 25 years of experience. The principal said, because you don't have 25 years of experience, like you say. You have only 1 year of experience 25 times. Have you just started over year after year with 25 years maybe of experience, but just 1 year of experience 25 times? She had refused to grow. She had refused to develop in her teaching skills, and for that she was rejected. So I wonder this morning if there's multitudes in our churches in the same category. Been in church all of these years, but still only have 1 year's worth of faith. 1 year worth of virtue or knowledge or temperance, patience, godliness, kindness, or charity. Understand something this morning. We should be adding with each passing year. Here's a new year. Here's a new opportunity to add something else. To begin to grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. How many is ready to grow up in 2021? I'm ready to grow up spiritually. I'm ready to, when you begin to grow up spiritually, you begin to accomplish and do things. Your dependence is upon God, yes, but you find that you take that dependence and you begin to become a skilled follower of Jesus Christ. Paul said in one place, he said, I was ready to give you meat, but you couldn't handle the meat, so I had to give you milk. We wonder why we don't get more out of the church service so many times. We have to keep on the milk because we're not ready for the meat. He said that I have so much more. God said, I have not seen, ear not heard, neither has it entered in the heart of man all the things that I have prepared. Oh, I'm ready to get to that place that we can experience Him in His deepness, in His fullness, in His glory, and His splendor. So can I ask you this morning, as we should be adding these things in our life, how well are you growing spiritually? How are you doing in the spiritual growth? How are you doing with adding these virtues and abounding in these virtues? I'm not here to shame anybody this morning, but I'm here extending a lifeline to tell you that God said 2021, restoration will continue. And so what does that mean? God is saying, my mercies are renewed in 2021. Some, he's brought restoration, and restoration has entailed and involved some hardships and some struggles in 2021. But God said, I'm ready to continue that process if you are. And for some, you've let 2020 pass you without any restoration whatsoever. You kind of stalled. You kind of stalled. You didn't grow any spiritually. Maybe you let the pandemic become an excuse and a reason for you to not get where you need to be in God. Whatever was the case, but don't let the past hinder your future. We're given a new beginning. That's the great thing about New Year. It gives us a chance to turn the page. Don't turn over a leaf, because a leaf is still a leaf on the other side. Turn the page. Turn the page. Begin to step into this faith. And as you begin to step into this faith, don't settle for that. Begin to add unto it all of those virtues that you may grow up. Are you ready to grow up this morning? That's how you do it. That's how you grow in spiritual knowledge. Tonight we're going to talk about the why we should be growing in this spiritual knowledge. But right now, I want you to just consider what Pastor has preached this morning on how we need to grow up spiritually and what needs to be done. Maybe you didn't do those things in 2020, but right here, first service of 2021, you say, I'm ready. If we were gathered together in the sanctuary, I'd call you to an altar. I would call you to the front of the sanctuary, where we have what's known as the mourner's benches, the altars, and the steps that represent our altars there in our beautiful sanctuary. But we're not in our sanctuary there, that building, but we are in the sanctuary today. So your couch, your recliner, your bedside, your steering wheel, that's your altar this morning. But if you feel God just dealing with your heart, maybe you're listening or watching this morning and you've not accepted Jesus as your Savior, and you're ready to start that spiritual growth for the very first time, here's your opportunity to do it. Maybe you're a backslider, that your growth has been stunted and you walked away from God, but you're ready to come back and start over again. This is your opportunity. Or maybe you just have stalled a little bit in your commitment over the last few days, few weeks, few months, maybe few years, but you want to get to that place to be a disciplined follower of Jesus Christ, and you want 2021 to be the year that you do that. This is your opportunity to make an altar somewhere. Call upon the name of the Lord. Because he said, all that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If the Spirit's drawing you, that's your opportunity to heed to his drawing and commit your ways unto him and begin to grow spiritually. Who's with me this morning? Who wants to do that? As I pray, I want you to just begin to ask the Lord, how would he have you pray? And how would he have you to respond to this message? And I want you to find you an altar somewhere and talk it over with the Lord. Let's pray. Father, I've delivered my heart this morning. I preached what I felt that you brought back to my heart and my attention to share with our congregation this morning. And Lord, I will continue this thought. Should you tarry, you're coming, and we're back tonight. I want to continue this thought. But right now, we're left here with this question of how can I grow spiritually? And I believe that we've laid it out in accordance to your word from Peter's writings, everything that we need to grow up spiritually. Now it's up to us to apply it to our lives. I pray, God, that you touch the heart of the listener, the heart of the viewer, that they can apply it to their lives today, and they can find that spiritual growth that they so desperately need. We ask it right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Find you an altar somewhere and begin to pray and begin to consider what pastors preached on this first Sunday of 2021. Come back and be with us tonight. Invite somebody to get online with you this evening and join us as we continue this thought of why we need to be growing spiritually. Love you, and you will see me tonight, and I hope that you come and join with us. God bless you. Love you. Everybody get well. Praise God.